Why did you decide to have a PhD?
If you're a good engineer, you say, what's the best way to solve it? But I think as a PhD, the question is much more of like, how many different ways can I solve this?
Why did you choose NLP?
I think it's something that's relatively easy to connect to as opposed to other things.
Can you describe the studying process in Stanford?
This was really popular. This was not very popular. You only have 10 weeks. Basically, everything here is very expensive.
But maybe you have some plans for, career after PhD?
Retirement.
What's your greatest strength?
Don't reveal your weaknesses, or like turn it around and like don't answer the question.
You have an experience of working in Microsoft, in startup, and Intel, and probably you interviewed people, right? And maybe you can talk something about Russian candidates and compare them with Americans.
Sure. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, most of the interviews I did was when I was at the startup. I was like the ninth employee, and by the time I left, we had 70 people, and so I helped interview a lot of them. And also, you know, you only hire kind of a small percentage of the people you actually interview. So I interviewed a ton of people. It's hard to say. I mean, you know, different people have different levels of language skills. Obviously, if it's not your native tongue, people will be kind of more self-conscious or kind of not as expressive or more formal. It really depends, like, person to person. I don't think that there's anything kind of particular about Russian speakers that I notice very, like, different or unusual. I'm also maybe not the best person to ask that question, because growing up in a house, like, you know, with my parents, like, speaking Russian all the time, and in a neighborhood that was, like, mostly Russian, I've kind of, any kind of, like, Russian cultural things, I'm usually pretty, like, familiar with. Yeah. And so, you know, maybe it's something that Americans will be like, oh, this is kind of weird, but, like, to me it seems normal. So I don't even, I wouldn't even be able to, like, distinguish things like
that.
Yeah,
yeah, I get it.
But I think one thing is that it is a little bit easier for me to understand people with, like, either, like, heavy Russian accents or something like that, because I can kind of guess what they're trying to say based on the way that they say it,
yeah.
Which probably is not true for people who don't spend as much time with Russian speakers.
But you said about people from Israel that that they very like direct, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what about Russian? I mean, in work, not in interview, just maybe in work.
Yeah, I mean, they tend to be a little bit more direct as well. I think probably everyone is more direct than Americans, so it's like a low bar, you know. But yeah, I mean, you know. I don't know, I've worked with many kind of Russian people, Russian speakers, people who recently came from Russian-speaking countries. In general, they're very good engineers. They, I'm not very familiar with, like, the education system in Russia or Russian-speaking countries, but they seem to have pretty strong fundamentals in computer science. They tend to do a really good job.
So, now we're going to talk about Stanford.
Okay.
It's very interesting. Why did you decide to have a PhD?
That's a good question.
It's interesting because you, like, have already an experience in your career going up. And why?
Yeah. So the PhD is a pretty different experience than software engineering, I think. I think the set of skills that you learn are pretty unique. I found myself kind of interested in spending more time, like, learning new things, and the best place to learn stuff is at a university. So I think many people who are more motivated to work by themselves, there's so many resources online to learn new things. But for me, I'm not one of those people, and so I thought the best way to do it is just to leave my job, go full in to, you know, into academia, to take classes again. Spent a lot of time taking classes here at Stanford to learn all the things that I've kind of missed out, a lot of stuff about machine learning, deep learning, AI, all this kind of stuff. But the PhD in particular is very interesting because it's much more about kind of exploring space that hasn't really been explored by anyone else. That's ideally like where you want to be. And it's about being like kind of very critical about like what problems exist and like what questions people are asking and how to evaluate them. And so I think these are very valuable skills to learn just like in life for your career. But obviously, you know, all of my research now is in natural language processing and machine learning and AI. And so it's a very popular thing right now,
yeah.
At least in the Bay Area. So, you know, I think it'll be beneficial to me. But I do see it as kind of a change in career from being a software engineer to being a researcher. Because it's much more about kind of like asking questions and exploring kind of new directions rather than kind of building things or kind of being really good at like engineering projects.
Does it give some other benefits to your future career?
Yeah, I mean, I think the main thing is just like the analytical skills that you mm-hmm. learn. Like I said, I think when you're an engineer, I think the way that you're kind of taught is to be like, okay, here's the problem. How do you solve it? Or maybe if you're a good engineer, you say, what's the best way to solve it? But I think as a PhD, the question is much more of like, how many different ways can I solve this? And can I come up with a good way to measure how well each solution applies? And then can I correctly express what are the benefits or drawbacks of each of the solutions? And so it's much more of a thing to kind of an exercise in like understanding problems or even just looking for problems. I mean, a big part of PhD is just kind of going around and being like, what are the things, what are the problems right now that like we need to solve, or like what are you know, like where can I find an interesting problem to work on?
Why did you choose NLP? Like I understand that it's very popular here, but maybe you have some other reasons.
NLP was, so I was first introduced to NLP in college. It was one of the classes that I took with Julia Hirschberg. She's a great teacher, great professor. I don't know, I was kind of always interested in it. I think it's something that's relatively easy to connect to as opposed to other things. You know, I mean, I think when you talk to people about like operating systems or distributed storage and data centers, people don't know what I'm talking about. And even in a lot of the like AI or machine learning type stuff, a lot of it is very like deep like math stuff, again, that isn't relatable to people. NLP is about natural language. It's about like the language that we use all the time. And so, you know, obviously we have our own kind of very specific problems that are maybe not obvious to everyone in the world, but the thing that we work on is something that everyone interacts with. And so I really like that. Most of the data in the world is still text, at least on the internet. So there's like lots of data to work on. There's lots of things to work on. And ultimately, you know, I mean, I'm personally very interested in like data and information and like education, and us as humans, like the best method that we've found to like transfer knowledge is through natural language, and so it seems like a good thing to study.
Okay, can you describe the studying process in Stanford? I mean, what's your classes and project and
so at least for the PhD, obviously the first year or maybe even 2 years you spend a lot of time taking classes, and then after that you're much more kind of independent. You're working with your advisor, you're finding projects, either your advisor kind of suggests projects to you or you come up with them yourself, and then the main goals there are to like publish papers, to find interesting things, and you get much more involved with the community of people who are publishing in the similar space. And it takes a long time actually, but you one of the things you have to learn as a PhD is you start reading many articles and you're like, okay, this is what people are interested in. Here's kind of like the response to things. You kind of look at Twitter and you're like, oh, like this was really popular. This was not very popular. And then, you know, you try to criticize kind of what they're doing. Oh, like maybe this isn't the best way. Maybe there's a better way. Maybe they're asking the wrong question. And then you try to do some work to show kind of your hypothesis. And then if it's successful, then you can publish it as well. So that's the PhD stuff. For classes, I mean, obviously, like, AI and ML is very popular here. I think there's, like, 100 different classes now that are, like, deep learning 4X, very popular classes. A lot of the classes are based on projects, which I was actually kind of surprised about. I think at Columbia, a lot of times we would finish with exams, whereas here, a lot of times, the like, 50% of the grade is based on, like, a group project that you do. Which, you know, has its like benefits and drawbacks. I mean, I think it gives you really good exposure to like working on interesting things and being able to like try new things that are maybe like almost research oriented. A lot of the projects you have to submit a paper that looks a lot like an academic paper that somebody would publish. But some of the drawbacks are like you only have 10 weeks, and so you're kind of like trying really hard to like finish something, and sometimes, you know, like your results aren't good, and it can be pretty intense.
Yeah. Is it expensive to be a student of PhD? I mean, I know that Stanford is the most expensive place, I mean, for studying. And what about PhD? Do you pay for something?
So the way the PhD works usually is it's kind of your professor's or your lab's job to get grants to fund your PhD. And so funding your PhD means kind of covering your costs as a student to be enrolled in the university and any kind of equipment that you need, like servers for running experiments and things like that. And so part of the time that you spend as a PhD student is writing grants or project proposals, and these things are sent to different places. Usually, the students focus more on, like, how can I publish my work and how can I get good results, and the professors focus more on, like, you know, who is a good person to kind of present this grant to and things like that. Mm-hmm. I don't have a lot of exposure to this. I'm pretty early in my PhD as well. So I think some of the older students, they'll get more involved if they're thinking about becoming professors themselves. Mm-hmm. But yeah, a lot of the PhD is about getting funding for the research that you're doing. In terms of just like the price of the lifestyle, yeah, I mean, the Bay Area, very expensive. Living here is very expensive. Basically everything here is very expensive. You know, I have some friends now, I'm working over the summer, that are from, like, Illinois, and they have, like, a huge house that they pay, like, almost nothing for in rent because there's tons of space there. And so, yeah, I mean, like, kind of it's much easier to get by over there than it is here.
Did you apply to other universities?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, PhD programs are very competitive, and they're very much... Like, your acceptance to them very much also depends on the availability of professors in your field. And so you could be, like, a great candidate, but if the thing that you're trying to do, like, that professor doesn't have money for more students or something, then, you know, you might not get accepted. So usually you apply to many schools. I applied to about 10 schools, I think.
And was successful in...
About 50-50.
Wow, it's okay. And why did you choose Stanford?
The best school in the country.
Okay. Why not MIT, for example?
That was one of the schools that didn't accept me.
Oh, okay. So what do you think about Silicon Valley? I mean, like a place for living and, of course, like a place for software development.
Yeah, I mean, it's a beautiful place. The weather here is amazing. We're hanging out right now. It's like 70 degrees, sunny, blue skies. So, it's a beautiful place to live. I personally really like being in the peninsula. I know a lot of people, they like to go into the city, move up to San Francisco. I love it here around Stanford, Palo Alto, Mountain View area. It's really nice. As you said, it's pretty expensive. So. Yes. You know, you have to pay to play, but you know, I think there's ways to kind of make lifestyle cheap and still really enjoyable. Me and my wife, we cook a lot at home to not be going out to restaurants all the time. And we like to just go out to parks. There's lots of nice parks and hiking and things like that that you can enjoy here. In terms of software and tech, there's probably no place in the world right now that is as exciting to be in for somebody who works in tech as Silicon Valley. Google, Amazon, Microsoft, Facebook, Nvidia, Intel, IBM, I mean, all, like, every, pretty much any company that you name, they have a major office here.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of really interesting stuff, really exciting stuff. For me as a PhD, looking at what Facebook and Google in particular are doing in academia, they've been kind of contributing a lot to academia, which is really exciting. So they're not just focused on, building up their products or like keeping their whatever research they do secret, but they're sharing their research and they're contributing a lot to academia, to research as well. So if you're somebody who wants to be more involved in research, again, Silicon Valley probably the best place for that. The only downside is there is a huge focus here on software. So if you're not in the software space, it can be kind of strange. Even people who aren't technical, who don't work in software engineering, they'll still be being a lawyer for a tech company or working at a firm that represents tech companies or working in kind of any number of other things. They're all somehow tied back to the tech thing.
Yeah. Why do you think 99% of startups start here, this business?
First of all, there's a lot of, because there's so much tech here, a lot of people come here to find jobs in tech. And so there's just a ton of engineers here. There's a lot of startups, I think, are spin-offs from companies, right? So it'll be a group of people, I hear this very often, there's a group of people who work together at a company, and they're like, hey, we can do something really cool, let's start our own company. They kind of spin off and then usually end up getting bought back by the same company. I think purely chasing the market kind of thing. Like, this is the easiest place to get investment probably as well.
Yeah. So. What's your plans for the future? For your future, of course.
Lots of studying.
Oh, okay.
And writing papers and training neural networks.
Are you gonna to get your degree?
You're not supposed to ask PhD students when they finish.
Okay.
It's it's very taboo.
But maybe you have some plans for, career up to PhD?
Retirement.
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, it's a very long way away, and so it depends a lot on the market, the economy. I think being a professor would be amazing. It's extremely competitive, very hard to kind of have been successful enough in your PhD to accomplish that. Obviously, a lot of opportunities here for working at different companies, a lot of opportunities to do a startup. So everything's open.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And you lived in Seattle, New York, and even in Israel and here.
And Boston.
And Boston. Yes, in Boston. And can you say what you like and what disliked in these countries, in these cities, of course?
Yeah. Yeah, each one is different. Each one has kind of their own culture to them. Even from a tech perspective, they have kind of different focuses. I think Boston is more focused on medical stuff and robotics. Seattle and the Bay Area are much more kind of like core tech stuff. New York is more finance stuff, I think. Israel, all over the place. Each one has its really nice parts and its downsides. Boston's a beautiful city. I really love living there. They have like a great culture, great kind of vibe to it.
The weather.
I don't mind. I grew up in New York, so the weather there was not bad. I love the snow actually. Mm-hmm. I really like getting just tons of snow and having to shovel it. It was fun for me. So yeah, I love that. Seattle has great skiing. New York has the best food of all the places. You know, here has the best weather. Israel has the nicest beaches. So I don't know. Every place has their benefits.
Yeah, it is. I would like to ask you to the most popular question in like recruiter. What's your greatest strength?
Oh yeah. So you know, I've heard a lot of really bad advice about these kind of questions, where they're like, kind of, you know, like don't reveal your weaknesses, or like turn it around and like don't answer the question. I don't subscribe to those things. I think, yeah. I mean, my advice is to be kind of very technical and to the point. For both like your strengths and your weaknesses. And so like something that I would say is kind of like, you know, for strengths, for example, you know, if you're interviewing for a place, you're probably bringing some kind of skills that maybe they don't really have at the time. And so, you know, you can say, okay, you know, I've spent whatever this many years working on this kind of tool set and this technology. I'm an expert in it, and I can like bring that expertise to your company. What are your weaknesses? We're always like learning, so pick the thing that you're learning right now and be like, you know, I'm really interested in generative models. I just started reading about them. I don't know them kind of very, very well. I'm really interested in like learning more about them, and I have a plan to kind of like go through and like learn a bunch of stuff and maybe do like a little side project on it. And you know, that kind of, I think is the best answer. It kind of gives people an idea of like what things you want to learn. You know, don't be like, my biggest weakness is that I'm a perfectionist or something. Like, yeah. Don't do that.
I think, and not only me, think that Americans are very good in self-selling, self-presentation, and Russians, no. Can you give them like advice, some advices for self-presentation? I mean.
Yeah. I mean, okay, first of all, I don't know to what extent that's true. I mean, I think Americans are probably the best at self-presentation in English because they've had the most practice. Obviously, they wouldn't be as good if they went to a different country and they didn't speak the language there. I think maybe Russian in particular, or like for Russians in particular, they tend to be a little bit more modest than Americans, and so sometimes it can be hard for them to be very direct about kind of like, you know, here's my strengths, here's what I'm really good at, like this is what I do. So I think that's something that Americans do well, kind of, especially if you're interviewing, even if you were part of a team, you know, say I did this, like, you know, like they're like, I built this, I worked on this, whatever. Yeah, I mean, you know, I think the main thing is to just think about, like, what are the skills that are important for the job that you're looking for, and then just, like, talk about the things that you've done that are either showing your accomplishments with those skills or, like, evidence that you learned those skills. I think it's much harder for, like, a soft skill type of thing where you're like, oh, I'm really motivated and I'm, like, hardworking. Like, it's kind of hard to prove those things. Unless you're really like a magical speaker, but you know, usually just kind of like, you know, I worked on this project, this thing was really challenging, and you know, I solved it by doing A, B, and C, and you know, like we were able to, I don't know, like have this many customers, this much sales, whatever, like, just kind of being very direct about it. Mm-hmm.
And the last question that I have for you is: do you have a person you would want to be like a professional wise?
There's a lot of people. I mean, I think one of the reasons I like the PhD program is it's very much based around mentorship, and so kind of rather than just taking classes, you're really working very closely with usually one person and just getting mentored by them. So obviously, have to give a lot of credit to my advisor Dan Drafsky for you know, kind of being a great advisor, and I look up to him in terms of like professionally as like his research and kind of his ability to be a great researcher.
Tell a couple words about him, like. What do you like?
I mean, he's super nice. He's like the nicest guy in the world. Brilliant, obviously. He's the fastest reader I've ever seen. Like, I think he might be able to read two lines of text at the same time or something, because I've seen him read like 8 pages in like half a minute or something. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Kind of figuring out the qualities to be an amazing researcher is hard. He's just been extremely successful at it for a very long time. And so just kind of trying to learn a little bit of the magic from him. But yeah, I mean, I think in general for everyone, kind of you always want to try to find yourself in a room with somebody that you think is impressive or successful and try to strive towards them, and try to be like them. And then hopefully at some point you find yourself somewhere else where you find somebody else who's kind of the next level, and then you try to strive towards them.
Yeah. Thank you very much for this interview.
Sure.
Спасибо. Спасибо вам, что досмотрели это видео. Я думаю, что вы почерпнули для себя очень много информации о том, как учиться в Стэнфорде, и, может быть, вдохновились этой историей, и когда-нибудь вы окажетесь в этих стенах как студент. На этом все. Спасибо еще раз. Всем пока. Встречаемся в следующем выпуске.